Now, assuming we have an optimally kneaded dough, we can move on to the next stage, fermentation. At this stage, the ability of wheat dough to hold gas produced by yeast is crucial here. This ability is known as gas retention, obviously. To explain gas retention of the dough, let's take a look at the expansion of a pita bread as it's heated up on the stove. As we have discussed before, the inflation of a pita dough on the stove can be explained with the first law of thermodynamics, a fundamental principle in physics. The first law of thermodynamics states that the change of internal energy of a system is equal to the heat absorbed by the system minus the external work done by the system. Let's take a look at this pita dough. By the first law of thermodynamics, we can be sure of the fact that it will rise when it is heated on the stove, and indeed, it does rise as predicted. The working principle is very simple. The pita dough can be roughly assumed to be a closed system that can retain gas. Matter cannot go in or out, but energy can. The moment we place the dough on our preheated stovetop pan, the heat of the pan is absorbed by the dough. And as explained before, carbon dioxide gas from the yeast and the steam from the water content in the dough eventually expand and are retained inside the pita dough. All of this contributes to the pressure that pushes the pita wall outward, forcing it to puff up. That's the way we visually see it, and technically speaking, this is the external work done by the dough. All of this shows that energy is conserved, because the heat energy from the pan gets transferred into the dough and then gets converted into its expansion, essentially. As long as the dough can retain the expanding gas, we are going to see a puffed up pita due to the first law of thermodynamics. This narration is correct with one assumption. We assume the dough is able to keep on expanding. So the next logical question to ask is, how far can the puff up continue? Or technically, how much energy can go in before the pita bursts? Well, if you're using European flour, you actually have a very close figure that you can quote to give you a general idea of what that energy is. I'm talking about the W index of the flour that you use to make the dough. The parameter W is called the deformation energy, as it represents the energy required to inflate the dough bubble until rupture, which is, in a way, represented by the work done by the gas within to expand the dough. This number is usually attained using an alveograph. An alveograph, again, is an empirical tool used to assess the baking quality of wheat flour. There is a positive, significant correlation between this parameter and bread volume. In bread dough, on a much smaller scale than the expansion of the pita dough, we can imagine lots of small bubbles expanding during fermentation and oven spring during baking. It happens in a similar fashion as the pita dough expanded on a stovetop pan. As mentioned earlier, during dough mixing, tiny bubbles are incorporated as nucleation sites. These small, spherical, tiny gas bubbles serve as starting points for gas expansion. During fermentation, most of the carbon dioxide produced by the yeast diffuses into these existing bubbles, causing them to grow. As gas bubbles expand, the dough film surrounding them are stretched in two directions parallel to the bubble surface. This type of deformation, known as biaxial extension, is analogous to inflating a balloon, where the material stretches in all directions along the surface. With further fermentation, as explained in this paper, above a volume fraction of approximately 0.7, these bubbles begin to deform each other significantly. The dough transforms into a foam with polyhedral gas bubbles separated by thin dough films, often referred to as membranes. These gas bubbles undergo a series of transformations during fermentation and baking. These transformations primarily involve disproportionation, bubble growth, and coalescence. Disproportionation, also known as Ostwald ripening, is the process where smaller gas bubbles shrink and disappear as gas diffuses into larger bubbles due to differences in internal pressure. This occurs primarily during the early stages of fermentation and can result in a decrease in the number of bubbles and an increase in their average size. Strain hardening can help limit disproportionation by slowing down the growth of larger bubbles. Strain hardening increases the stress in the dough film surrounding expanding gas bubbles, creating resistance to further growth, especially for larger bubbles. As the dough film stretches, strain hardening causes its resistance to extension to increase more than proportionally to the applied strain. Consequently, the stress around a bubble that has grown significantly is greater than that around a bubble that has grown less. This difference in stress discourages further growth of the already larger bubbles, and in turn reduces the driving force for gas transfer between bubbles of different sizes. Bubble growth occurs mainly during fermentation and baking as a result of carbon dioxide production by yeast fermentation and gas expansion due to rising temperatures. The rate of bubble growth is influenced by factors like yeast concentration and dough rheology. Doughs with higher strain hardening values tend to exhibit slower bubble growth rates. Coalescence refers to the merging of adjacent bubbles when the thin liquid films separating them ruptures. Coalescence can lead to the loss of gas from the dough, resulting in a smaller loaf volume. Furthermore, extensive coalescence can contribute to an uneven crumb structure. Coalescence can occur during the later stages of proofing and baking, particularly as the gas volume fraction increases and the films between bubbles becomes thinner. When a dough film experiences biaxial extension, as occurs around an expanding gas bubble, strain hardening causes its resistance to extension to increase more than proportionally to the applied strain, as we've mentioned before. This means the dough becomes progressively stronger as it stretches, preventing the formation of weak spots that are susceptible to rupture. Dough, as a natural material, contains inhomogeneities, leading to variations in film thickness. Strain hardening stabilizes those inherent weak spots. If a section of the film becomes locally thinner, strain hardening ensures that the resistance to further thinning at that spot is greater than in the thicker parts. This localized increase in resistance counteracts the tendency for the thin spot to become progressively thinner and eventually rupture, thus maintaining the film's integrity. In a polyhedral foam structure, which develops as gas bubbles grow and come into contact, the films between adjacent bubbles experience varying levels of stress. Strain hardening helps to equalize this stress distribution, preventing excessive stress concentration on thinner films. This promotes uniform expansion of the gas bubbles and reduces the likelihood of film rupture and subsequent coalescence. Biaxial extension is a primary mode of deformation that the dough experiences during later stages of bread making. So bulk fermentation, resting, shaping with or without pre-shaping, proofing, and oven spring are all as important as mixing and kneading in bread making. Okay, we've covered a lot of interesting information. Now let's put all of this into practice. So central to bread making is the development of a gluten network, and sufficient hydration is crucial for forming a robust gluten network. In real use scenarios, wheat doughs can have hydrations as low as around the mid-30s to as high as 100% or even higher. Throughout this range of hydration, we can observe strain hardening as we knead and stretch our doughs. During fermentation and oven spring of baking, cooking or steaming for low hydration wheat dough. If you pay attention to each phase of the dough's development, you would see that it parallels the stress-strain curve observed in material science, though the specific phases and behaviors may not be identical. Nevertheless, we see similar phases of development, including elasticity, yield, plasticity, strain hardening, necking, and rupture. Having made breads with a wide spectrum of hydration, we know that the impacts of hydration on each of these phases and the gluten components of the dough are different for different dough hydrations. Extreme high hydration dramatically increases the mobility of gluten in molecules, enabling them to align and interact more readily. This can lead to the rapid formation of a gluten network. That's why when handling dough with extreme hydration, we can mix our dough without much effort, and we certainly aren't required to knead the dough vigorously. With this kind of hydration, we don't really have to do that much to build the elasticity of the dough. And as a matter of fact, we shouldn't. While beneficial initially, the heightened mobility due to hydration makes the gluten network more vulnerable to damage from excessive mixing or kneading. The balance between rapid gluten development and susceptibility to overmixing is crucial. Careful control of mixing or kneading time is essential to avoid weakening the dough structure. The effect of glutenin macropolymer depolymerization during mixing is more pronounced in highly hydrated systems. High hydration levels likely weaken hydrogen bonds within the gluten network. Water mobility within the gluten matrix increases, leading to the disruption of hydrogen bond interactions. This effect is due to water molecules competing with gluten proteins for hydrogen bonding sites. As water content increases, a greater proportion of gluten protein binding sites are occupied by water molecules, reducing the frequency of interprotein hydrogen bonds. This increases protein mobility, making GMP more susceptible to breakdown from the mechanical forces of mixing, destabilizing the gluten network and potentially leading to a weaker, less cohesive structure, as is often seen in wet doughs. The abundance of heightened depolymerization contributes to the presence of smaller glutenin polymers. Consequently, resting is particularly crucial for high hydration doughs to allow sufficient time for the repolymerization of GMPs and the development of a stable gluten network. In practice, after we mix the high hydration dough together and ensure all ingredients are fully hydrated, we let it rest for around 30 minutes. This, as you may have noticed, is at the low end of the ideal resting time for an optimal gluten network formation, which is around 30 to 60 minutes. Then we move on to the strain hardening phase using methods like stretch and folds. Depending on the dough's condition, this may involve a few sets of stretch and folds, each followed by about a 30-minute rest. By the end of each set, we can feel the strain hardening taking effect on the dough. This is essentially how we work with extremely high hydration doughs. During fermentation, shaping, and oven spring, the dough continues to undergo strain hardening, which, of course, contributes to its strength and structure. High hydration breads typically have an open and airy texture, and with proper baking, they can also develop a crispy crust. Conversely, under low hydration, competition for water between starch and gluten proteins intensifies, potentially hindering gluten development. This limited water availability restricts the hydration of gluten proteins, affecting their mobility and interactions, leading to a weaker and less cohesive dough. Lower hydration levels can influence both the depolymerization and repolymerization of GMP during mixing. Lower hydration can also influence the secondary structure of gluten proteins, altering the balance between elements like alpha helices and beta sheets. The presence of water enhances hydrogen bonding within gluten proteins, contributing to the formation of alpha helices and beta sheets. Therefore, under low hydration, the reduced hydrogen bonding might lead to a less ordered secondary structure, potentially impacting gluten network development. In practice, to overcome this shortcoming, we usually need more and apply more effort to the low hydration dough to get it to the peak of its elasticity phase. There are actually many creative techniques that people have come up with to knead the dough, from brute force hand kneading to using an assortment of tools. Essentially, higher mechanical or physical energy input during mixing promotes gluten network formation and increases dough strength. So after rigorous kneading, we let the dough have a long rest, around 45 to 60 minutes. And you may have noticed this is at the higher end of the ideal resting time for optimal gluten network formation, which is around 30 to 60 minutes again. At the core of this matter, you want the dough at this stage to have a sufficient level of elasticity to move on to the next phase. For efficiency, although it may not be that effective, I usually roll the dough, sort of sheeting it. This way of handling the dough seems to work for my type of bread flour, and after that, I cut the dough into the shape of the noodles I want and cook them. The rest of the strain hardening process will take place when these noodles are cooked, or when the low hydration dough is cooked, and that's how you have homemade chewy noodles. Between these two extremes of hydration, there is a sweet spot in the middle where the dough can optimally develop under the right hydration. Optimal hydration provides the necessary water for gluten proteins to hydrate effectively, facilitating their mobility and interaction, thus fostering the development of a strong and continuous gluten network. Optimal hydration is a critical factor that facilitates gluten development during mixing and dough development, creating a harmonious interplay between gliadins, glutenins, GMP, and the secondary structure of gluten proteins. Bringing it up again, the mechanical force of mixing can cause the depolymerization of GMP, breaking it down into smaller units. However, under optimal hydration, glutenin subunits can reassemble during dough resting, leading to a partial recovery of GMP. Optimal hydration promotes the formation of ordered secondary structures in gluten proteins as well, such as alpha helices and beta sheets, which are stabilized by hydrogen bonds. These structures are vital for the gluten network's strength, elasticity, and extensibility. In practice, this dough is easy to handle. We knead our way all through the elasticity phase and up to the peak, and then we let it rest or bulk ferment in an ideal room temperature around 30 degrees Celsius. That's for the yeast. This usually takes around 45 minutes. This timing is perfectly at the middle of the ideal resting time for optimal gluten network formation. Again, around 30 to 60 minutes. During bulk fermentation, the fermentation through the gas expansion and the gas bubbles induce strain hardening. And later on, we can stretch it again during pre-shaping and after a quick bench rest, shaping, and then after that, baking. Most soft breads, shokubang, dinner rolls, burger, and hot dog buns are usually made this way. Breads made with such a dough in optimal conditions typically have a great texture with a fine and even crumb, a high specific volume, and these breads are usually also very fluffy as well as soft. In this video, for the sake of simplicity, I have shied away from discussing many essential ingredients and derivative ingredients that we regularly use that might have an influence on strain hardening, say salt, tangzhong or yudane, fat, eggs, and so on. These topics I'll leave to future videos. And that's it for today. Thanks for watching, and bye!